G'day everyone, I am the man called Kemosabe, the man with the plan from the land down under, and this is my review of Bloodhunt by Simon Potier and Adam AF. As usual, we'll take a look at the cover, the story, then talk about the good, the bad, and the ugly of this book. The cover has a heavy 90s vibe. No surprise, as this book is a love letter to the gonzo horror and action comics of that era. Vincent, the main character from Bloodhunt, wouldn't be out of place alongside some of Brian Pulido's creations. While I'm not a fan of the smudgy title, the thick lines, and the smoke plume, everything else about this cover is perfect. The cool but casual pose of the main character, the full moon halo behind him, the layers of corpses that get more complex and numerous as they approach the character known as the Reaper. Each layer coloured differently to create a definite foreground, midground and background. It's clear from the get-go what sort of book you're getting when you look at the cover. You know it's going to be big, colourful action, backflips, guns akimbo, over-the-top flair, and the book doesn't disappoint. The book is paced like a movie, the first in a trilogy maybe. We start right before the third act, the final showdown. Vincent, world-renowned assassin, sometimes called the Reaper, a newly undead, catches us up on his predicament. He's undead, and the man who is responsible for this is his current employer and the father of the woman he loves, the woman he'd kill and die for. After arranging for Isabella to be out of harm's way, Vincent prepares to storm his target's mansion fortress. The narrative then leaps back 24 hours and we learn how Vincent came to be this way. Vincent meets with his boss, who gives him a job the hitman refuses. He says it's beneath his talents. The boss triples his normal fee and says he'll allow Vincent to marry his daughter if he does the job. Vincent is surprised the boss knows about their relationship but agrees to his terms. Vincent's boss also reminds him that this kill needs to look completely natural, no weapons. Vincent comments on the lack of security and how anyone could kill this one old man. An assassin as skilled as him is wasted on a job like this. He smothers the old man and turns to leave, thinking the task is complete. The old man rises and attacks Vincent with preternatural strength, claiming to be a vampire. The old man survives being shot and levitates around the room, toying with the hitman. Vincent is losing the fight, and after being bitten and disarmed, he desperately grabs a piece of debris and kills the vampire with it. Vincent passes out and sees his life flash before his eyes. In a trance, he rises and feeds off the dead vampire before collapsing and then experiencing the vampire's life and memories. When he finally awakens, he is healed, has fangs, and hungers. The vampire's phone sounds off and Vincent sees a message from his boss to the vampire. They were in cahoots. Vincent's boss works for this vampire and set the hitman up to die. Vincent burns the body in the house and swears vengeance on his boss. As he walks the streets of the city, he sees monsters, demons, and gargoyles, where before he saw men and women. His condition seems to give him the ability to see the supernatural beings that secretly inhabit our world. He is overcome with hunger and kills a human woman while feeding on her. He's attacked by a group of vampires for feeding on their turf, but Vincent is able to match their power despite being outnumbered. It is hinted that the old vampire was a particularly powerful ancient being, and by feeding from him, Vincent has access to more power than a newborn vampire should have. He kills the group, one by one, and feeds on each one, adding centuries of power and knowledge to his repertoire each time he does. The vampires condemn him, saying feeding from supernatural sources is forbidden by the council. But Vincent doesn't care for their rules and unlocks the ability to grow rending claws and to fly during this fight. After he kills the vampire crew, he flies away, heading home before he loses control and crashes into a taxi. The driver seems familiar with vampires and their laws. He reveals he is an Nephilim, an emotional vampire, and he drives Vincent to the airport. Vincent returns home and gears up to take the fight to his former boss. The first issue ends with Vincent vowing not to feed upon the innocent, instead taking sustenance from the undead patrons of a vampire bar. The second book ramps up the action and the lore considerably. Think the shift in tone from Blade to Blade 2. It gives Vincent his revenge, reveals the reasons for his betrayal, and shows us more of this supernatural world, including the council, werewolves, and other supernatural beings. The second book ends with a new status quo and is the perfect jumping off place for the next book in this series. This book is faithful to the gonzo art and stories of the 90s. Again, Vincent could have been a character existing in the same world as Evil Ernie, Purgatory, or Lady Death. He is a heavy metal, leather-clad, dual-scythe, gun-wielding quip machine. He is Vampire Duke Nukem with a mile-a-minute mouth. He is a globe-trotting assassin with a mansion, Lamborghini, huge bank account, and form-fitting skull-encrusted combat armor. And that's before he becomes one of the most powerful vampires in the world. The book moves along at a fast pace. Vincent doesn't waste a lot of time reflecting and navel-gazing. He spends the first half of the story reacting to things that are happening to him, but once he finds his feet, he takes to the offensive and begins affecting the world around him. Loud is fantastic, action-packed with cartoonish proportions that reflect the inhuman frames of the vampires, werewolves, and other supernatural beings. The fights, and there are a lot of them, are particularly well done. It's clear what is happening. The flow from panel to panel during the action is intentional, and you can follow the cinematic battles easily. Oh, how I wish this book was coloured. Sim does a great job on the art, and it's strong enough to stand on its own in black and white, but those 90s Pulido comics' greatest strengths were the bombastic colours, the bright tones that seared the eyes of the teenagers lucky enough to get a hold of them. All the blood and lurid colours would have added to the 90s feel, and would help clear up a few of the awkward but infrequent transitions in non-combat scenes. There are a few places where panels merge into one another and create hard-to-read or confusing pages. The book starts with a lot of exposition. Vincent catches us up on things, who he is and why he's doing what he does. He's clearly a very arrogant, self-assured character. There's even an editor's note reinforcing this idea. He's a killer. He's called the Reaper after all. This is quickly juxtaposed against his relationship with Isabella. She's his whole world, his angel, his sunshine. He says he can only truly be himself around her. This sets a stark contrast with everything else about this character. I've talked before about the motivation mechanism, the idea that too often, and 80s and 90s action movies were the worst offenders for this, the hero is given a neat little family or woman he loves just so they can be killed and give him reason to take action. This is fine for popcorn flicks and two-hour action sequences. The audience doesn't need much more than this. The best of these movies give us some real deep and resonating interactions so we believe and join the hero on his quest. I'm thinking of Taken or The Crow, where the crimes of the bad guys and the love the hero has for his daughter-slash-wife-slash-family is so great you're spurred into feeling, into caring, when they are harmed. Mid-tier offerings might give us a little montage of the hero and his loved ones interacting, like the opening of Schwarzenegger's Commando, Matrix and Chen-Yi eating ice cream and fishing at the beach. You believe he cares, so when she is taken, you care as well. These are the most common scenes back in the day, little montages of the hero doing mundane real-life tasks and activities to let you know that this is his normal, the way he wants to exist. Despite being a virtual god of death and battle, he'd rather eat ice cream and read music magazines with his kid. And that's fine, it works, it's reliable. The least effective, I think, is like this comic or like the Renegade TV series or early Steven Seagal movies, where we are very quickly told how much the hero loves the wife, girlfriend, child before they are killed or kidnapped. Without some evidence of the protagonist's feelings in action, it's hard to believe this cold-blooded killer could ever truly love another. When you love another more than you love yourself, and you become aware that others love like you do, how can you then kill someone and take them away from the person they love? It's like when you have kids. Until you have kids, you don't really understand the depths of the character's rage when they are taken from him. You understand it mechanically, it makes sense, but you can't really imagine the terror until you also have a child to lose. There is a significant disconnect here in the early pages. We have a leather-clad, bladed, gun-wielding vampire mass murderer and hitman who also has it in him to wholly and selflessly love another, and we believe that because he tells us it's true? You can go the telling route, if you want. I've seen it work. In Unforgiven, William Money tells anyone who will listen how much he loved his wife, how she changed him from his terrible, sinful ways, turned him from a killer and a drunk into a better man. He says it so often you realise he hates who he was and he is immensely grateful for the change she was able to inspire in him. You also realise with her dead, he fears he will slip back into those old ways and he desperately does not want to become that man again. This is the direction Sim could have taken with Vincent, have him planning to leave the business, having him botch the last couple of assignments because now that he's in love, now that he knew what it was like to be loved, he couldn't easily kill anymore. Every time he killed a man, he realized he was killing a son, a father, a husband, a brother. This seemingly easy job could be his last chance to redeem himself to the mob. He's planning on using it to escape the criminal life with Isabella. Isabella's father is counting on Vincent not surviving this hit. Show Vincent's conflict, his desire to love and be loved, the way he has changed and can no longer be the man, the monster he was. Just as he's rediscovered his humanity, just as he rejoins mankind and refuses to kill ever again, he is forcibly changed into a vampire, a literal monster, one who has to kill to live. This then supports his decision to kill other vampires and humans that he deems guilty. This gives him nobler motivations and ultimately creates a more likable character. Instead, Sim prefaces Vincent's decision to not kill what he dubs the innocent with a montage of Vincent's greatest hits, men and women he has killed. Despite being a mob hitman, coincidentally and conveniently, all of his victims just happen to be engaged in activities such as smuggling children and dealing drugs. That justifies even a mafia hitman holding the high ground and being justified in killing them. I think this whole thing would have worked better if Vincent had killed innocents and the weight of what he'd done was weighing on him, and combined with his reawakened empathy from falling in love with Isabella, led him towards a redemptive path. He would have been more likable and we could have empathized with him more easily if he showed some remorse, if he was fighting to be a better man. People love a redemption arc. They love the idea of a flawed man changing, doing better, being a better man, overcoming his flaws and his crimes. Sometimes it looks like sacrificing themselves for another. Sometimes it looks like fighting to protect the very sort of people they used to prey upon. Instead, Vincent is a mafia hitman who quips and curses like a sailor when he kills people. But fortunately, he only has to kill people worse than him. I think in a desire to make the character likable, by precluding him from committing any really horrible crimes, Sim has made the character less likable. It's a little bit too pat, too convenient. It feels like the author didn't want his character tarnished in any way and tried to make him the bestest, baddest, most murderous killer, who also falls in love like a schoolboy and never really killed anybody who doesn't deserve it. He quips about life and death and mocks the people he kills, never showing regret or pathos. Even when he gets turned into a vampire, he only ramps up the one-liners, mocking everybody he harms. He kills an innocent woman to feed and has less than a panel's worth of regret over it. I believe someone truly bad, someone who hurt men and women and children, who then finds redemption, is a more likable and believable character than one who acts like a horrible person, but is saved by plot convenience from actually being depicted as one. And honestly, Evil Ernie or Lady Death wouldn't have shown regret or pathos for killing anyone opposing them either. My assessment of Vincent's character might fly directly in the face of what Sim set out to do. He seems to be aiming for the cooler-than-cool character, the to-the-extreme character, in which case my previous concerns might not apply. I said the motivation mechanism can be done well. Unforgiven, The Crow, Taken, the series Banshee. Maybe Sim didn't want to waste precious page real estate on all those feelings and talking and philosophizing. Maybe this talented artist just wanted to make a badass character who gets into lots of cool fights because that's what he wanted to draw. I reviewed a book called Elysian Fields recently and decided that it was a book made to be cool, to be fun, to tell an action-packed story without all those pesky subplots and all that character development. I said in that review that it's okay to just make something that is cool to look at and cool to read, something that you read and enjoy and escape for a while and put on your shelf until next year or the year after when you read it again. There are some movies I'll watch endlessly. I don't always seek them out, but if they're on, I'll stop what I'm doing and watch them. Roadhouse, Unforgiven, Fury Road, Taken, The Crow, Dread. These are movies I can watch over and over again. Some of them are escapism. Some have messages and themes. I think if the indie scene wants to challenge the mainstream, if we want to compete with the Batmans and Spider-Mans that they have an iron grip on and seem determined to devalue and use up, if we want to create lasting IPs that people choose to choose over these long-standing and iconic characters, it is the stories that will get us there. We should be aiming for memorable, deep-running and impactful stories. How often will a reader return to these hey that's cool type books? How often will they read these action oriented books, these books that skimp on character development and subplot? You can use books like these as a foundation to build your publishing empire on, and as a showcase for some of your talents. These comics have every right to exist and you have every right to make them. But if you want repeat customers, if you want rising funding levels and more backers with every campaign, think of those comics and movies you return to time and time again. Think about why you reread them and what it is about them that makes them timeless. What makes them resonate with you, and see if you can't steal some part of that to create comics or have people thinking about them long after they've put them down. That brings us to the end of the video. Thanks for watching. Please consider liking and subscribing, and I hope you join me on the next one. Take care.